Before Roald Amundsen was even born, Europe was already starting to colonize parts of Africa. He was born in the second wave of European colonization, and this time Europe was after Africa. After the European countries got all of Africa they could, they wanted the North and South Pole next. Roald Amundsen was born July 16, 1872, in Bjerke, Norway, near Oslo. He was the fourth son to his parents, Jens Amundsen and Hannah Selvest. At an early age, he became fascinated by polar exploration. He would sleep with his bedroom window open during the worst Norwegian winter to help condition himself for the freezing temperatures in the Arctic, because he knew he was going to be a polar explorer. His father was a ship owner, so he was always around ships and near the ocean. This only helped fuel his fascination and want to explore the ocean by boat. His mother, on the other hand, was not nearly as supportive as his father. She wanted him to become a doctor and go into medical school. He fulfilled her wishes and went into medical school until she died when he was only 21. Right after her death, he went straight into fulfilling his dreams of becoming a polar explorer. Ronald was a crew member on a variety of ships that traveled the Arctic. The first big exploration he was a part of was on a Belgian ship named Belgica. He was the first mate of Adrien de Clichy of the Belgian Navy. The ship left Antwerp, Belgium on August 16, 1897. The Belgica crossed the Arctic Circle on the 15th of February, 1898, off the Palmer Land on the Arctic Peninsula. The men of the Belgica made the first ever land excursion onto Antarctica, spending a week ashore in an attempt to travel inland. De Clichy, the captain of the Belgica, later ventured further south in an attempt to beat the furthest south record held by James Ross, but it was too late in the season to go any further south, and by the 3rd of March, 1898, the Belgica was trapped in a sea of ice in the Bellingshausen Sea by Alexander Island. So because they got iced in, they became the first ship to winter in Antarctica. Amundsen learned many valuable lessons that would help later when he would go to both the North and South Pole. One lesson that he learned is that fresh seal meat was a great source of vitamin C, which would help in curing scurvy. Another lesson was to use animal skin rather than wool coats to keep warm. The Belgica was finally able to break out of the ice in Antarctica on February 15, 1899, and on March 14th made into open water past the ice. After he got back from sailing on the Belgica, Amundsen was still hungry for some more exploring. He decided that he was going to travel through the Northwest Passage. The Northwest Passage is an area of water above Canada that connects the Pacific Ocean to the Atlantic Ocean. He would make the journey through the Northwest Passage on a ship named Gioa.
He left Oslo for Norway on June 16, 1903, with his crew of six men. His crew consisted of Godfred Hansen, who was a naval lieutenant, Helmer Hansen, an experienced ice pilot, Anton Lund, an experienced sailing captain, Peter Risdet, the chief engineer aboard the Gioa, Gustav Jule Wick, a gunner in the Royal Norwegian Navy, and Adolf Lundstrom, the cook for all the crew members.
The first stop on a three-year-long journey through the Northwest Passage was the Labrador Sea, which is west of Greenland. Next, they crossed the Baffin Bay, then navigated the icy Arctic archipelago.
By late September, Gioa was west of the Bootitha Peninsula and began to encounter worsening weather and sea ice. Amundsen put Gioa into a national harbor on the south shore of King William Island on October 3rd. She was iced in. The Gioa remained here for the next 2 years. All the time the crew had while waiting for the ice to melt, the crew would go on different explorations around the island to get measurements to find out the location of the magnetic North Pole and learn from the local Inuit people on King William Island. Gioa left King William Island on August 13, 1905, and made its way through the treacherous waters south of the Victoria Island, and from there west into the Beaufort Sea north of Alaska. By October, Gioa was iced in again, and this time near the Herschel Islands in the Yukon. Amundsen left his men aboard and spent much of the winter skiing 500 miles south to Eagle, Alaska, to telegraph news of his exploration success. He returned in March, but Gioa remained icebound until July 11th. Gioa reached Nome, Alaska on August 31st, 1906. He sailed to earthquake-ravaged San Francisco, California, where the exploration was met with the hero's welcome on October the 9th. Rather than sail her around Cape Horn and back to Norway, the Norwegian-American Committee in San Francisco wanted Amundsen to sell them the ship. The ship was donated to the city of San Francisco, and the ship was dragged up the beach to the northwest corner of the Golden Gate Park, surrounded by a low fence and put on display. Amundsen knew that the success of this journey would make his name more well-known. This would make it easier for him to be able to do other explorations he wanted to do. The next exploration that was on Amundsen's mind was to be the first man to make the South Pole. What most people didn't know at the time is that he originally was going to travel to the North Pole, but there were some rumors going around that another Arctic explorer named Robert Peary had already made it to the North Pole, so he changed his plans to go to the South Pole instead. The first thing Amundsen needed to make this journey was a ship, and because of his successful journey through the Northwest Passage, it caught the eye of an explorer named Fridtjof Nansen. Nansen was the owner of a ship named the Fram. The Fram was the first custom-built ship for ice work, so it made it a lot easier to make it through the ice near the Antarctic. The crew Amundsen would take consisted of Olav Jalin, Hilmar Hansen, Sylvia H. Hessel, and Oster Visting. Amundsen was in a race to the South Pole with British explorer Robert Scott, so he didn't tell anyone but his brother that he was going to change his plans from the North Pole to the South Pole. He left Norway in June 1910. He sailed directly from the Madeira Islands, western Morocco, to the Bay of Whales in Antarctica, along the Ross Sea. They arrived at the Bay of Whales in early 1911. Their base camp, named Framheim, would be located 60 miles closer to the pole than where Scott's base camp was located. He would make the journey to the South Pole with four of his crew members, 52 dogs, and four sleds, where Scott was using Siberian ponies. Olav Jalin was able to redesign the sled to make it lighter. He was able to reduce the weight of the sled from 294 pounds down to 50 pounds. This lower weight would be crucial in saving energy on the trip.
They were also able to hit good weather, which made the trip easier and helped them to beat Scott to the pole. He raised the Norwegian flag at the South Pole on December 14, 1911, with only 16 of the sled dogs surviving. They stayed at the pole for a few more days to collect scientific data before beginning the return journey back to base camp on December 17, 1911. They left a small tent and a letter stating their accomplishments in case they didn't return safely to the Framheim. They made it safely back to base camp at the Bay of Whales on January 25, 1912, with 11 surviving dogs. Scott didn't make it to the pole until January 17, 1912, 33 days after Amundsen and his crew had made it. Scott's return journey was a little more difficult than Amundsen's. They had to travel through one of the worst winters Antarctica had ever had at the time. Due to the horrible weather, Scott and his team did not make it back to the base camp and were later found that they had frozen to death. Amundsen and his crew made their way off Antarctica and headed to Hobart, Australia, where Amundsen publicly announced his successful trip on March 7th. He telegraphed news to backers that he had made it. With funds resulting from his Antarctic adventures, Amundsen established a successful shipping business. He then acquired a new ship, the Maud, and tried in 1980 to complete his old goal of traveling across the North Pole, but he was forced to abandon his journey in favor of trying to reach the North Pole by airplane. In 1925, he was finally able to make the trip over the North Pole in a flight with explorers Lincoln Ellsworth and Umberto Noble. He arrived within 150 feet of the pole.
When they flew over the North Pole, the three guys each dropped their country's flag. Amundsen dropped the Norwegian flag, Ellsworth dropped the American flag, and Noble dropped the Italian flag.
Amundsen was looking for some missing team members whose plane crashed while traveling back to the North Pole. Amundsen's plane crashed in the fog of the Barents Sea north of Norway. Amundsen and his crew were killed in the crash or died shortly after, and their bodies were never found.
Without Amundsen's first polar exploration, there would not be nearly as much information about the poles as there is. Because Amundsen was able to show the world that it's possible to make the South Pole thrive, scientists like Dr. Matthew Schnoop of the NOAA, who said in an interview they wouldn't be as far in the research as they are because of early polar exploration. Dr. Schnoop also said that he, along with many other scientists, were able to go to Antarctica on a ship, the Icebreaker, and collect data about the ice to learn about the past of Antarctica. Without Roald Amundsen and early polar exploration, we wouldn't be able to travel, let alone live, on the beautiful continent called Antarctica.